up, fellow music nerds? We're back again for another edition of What Makes Music Awesome. Today, I wanted to talk to you about good melodies. I know it's completely subjective, and there are so many combinations that have been created with notes to create melodies, you know, and then you throw in culture with it, as well as history and all of that. But there are certain factors that each melody has in common to make it a stronger melody, regardless of country, era, instrument, or anything. And so I thought I'd go over those. And I want to apologize ahead of time. I know this is like, hang on a second, this is the most beautiful balcony side chat, so warning ahead of time for background noise, birds and helicopters and things. But hey, nature rocks, right? So anyway, all right, so good melodies. What makes up a good melody? First thing is you want consistency. And the whole idea of the art of constructing a line, a melody, is to create a balance between predictability and surprise. The human ear, you know, we grow up in a certain tradition, regardless of what the tradition is, and that tradition has a lot of patterns to it, right? And our human brains love patterns. So when a melody incorporates patterns, we latch onto it. Now, the artistic part is when a composer says, well, okay, how much pattern do I want to give you, and when do I want to break that pattern? And that is what affects our emotions and our response to that melody. So if you have a melody that has very few notes and just a ongoing pattern, la 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 la, you can go on forever. And or you remember this song? This is the song that never ends. Yes, it goes on and on, my friend. Some people started singing it not knowing what it was, and they'll continue singing it forever just because this is a song that doesn't end. So the more pattern, the more boring it gets really quickly. And that's when the composer puts in the unpredictable elements to catch our ear off guard. So consistency of material, balance between variety and consistency is a fantastic, one of the most important elements of a good melody. Now, flow and direction and momentum. Again, if you only have a handful of notes that maybe just go up and down a little bit, I'm just gonna make something up. La 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 la. There's no direction to it. You could even go la. And it just kind of goes on and on and on, and you don't know where it's going. Again, so there's no direction to it. The momentum is aimless, right? So you want a melody that goes somewhere. That includes giving the melody good landing points. Twinkle, twinkle, little star, how I wonder where you are. That's a landing point, right? Clear and understandable climaxes. La 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 la. Anyway, so there's momentum to it, right? Forgive the bad singing. Interesting shape. I'm gonna play you a couple examples. So a shape that, again, is not random. It goes up and then it goes down, and maybe goes up a little again, and maybe goes down again. So but there's a predictable shape, and it's interesting. You know, if your melody just flat lines, maybe moving a little bit like this, it's not going anywhere. There's no interest to it. And again, sometimes people think they can get away with the melody just doing this, and then the accompaniment doing interesting stuff. And yes, sometimes that works. That is a clever technique to keep in your arsenal. But if that's all the melody does for the entire song, then that's going to end up with a boring melody, right? You want to alternate. Again, the whole concept of it's alternating and balance. And ultimately, all this together creates a catchy sound. The mind likes it. It's unpredictable, but then we have something to latch on to. So this brings up another question. What is it that our ear latches onto? Our ear latches onto the highest pitch, or sometimes the lowest pitch, depending on where the melody is going. We hear the outsides. If you listen to a choir singing, when they're splitting up into parts, you hear the sopranos, and you hear the basses. Everything else just kind of fills it in, right? So you hear the outermost stuff, the topmost and the bottommost. You hear action, you hear stuff that's going on that's different than the surroundings. If all you have is static, non-moving accompaniment, and then you hear this melody going around, we'll hear a couple of examples of that coming up, then you're gonna listen to that melody moving around. Likewise, in contrast, if you have this crazy stuff going on in the background, and then this melody that is, you're gonna follow that because it's different. Basically, we follow what's different as far as action goes. Novelty, how if you have this persistent thing going on, we're gonna listen to a little bit of Ravel later on with, he introduces this four note ostinato. La 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 la. And the ostinato just goes on and on and on and on and on. The minute something new happens, our ear goes, oh, something is new going on. So our ear picks up contrast, highs and lows, loudness versus softness, activity versus non-activity, string texture versus woodwind texture, different textures, rhythm versus sustained sound, and the combination of the two, the back and forth, that is what contributes to the flow and the interest and the build of not only the entire piece of music, but just the melody. So as you can see from this first example, take a listen to this. I mean, you can call it a melody, but we all know it's pretty much a major scale. What about this one? You can see these are all the notes of the same previous one octave scale, but they're all mixed up. Now something like that could definitely be workable as the beginnings of a melody, but as it stands, it's pretty haphazard and it's not very memorable because there's nothing for our ear to grab onto, right? Let's check out this one. If you now just look at the notes, they are rising up essentially in the way of a scale with a little bit of creative wiggling around, right? But just looking at the rhythm, I mean, shoot, it looks pretty scary. Again, it's creative and fun, definitely has potential, but on its own, it's nothing memorable and very unpredictable, difficult to hum along, if you will. Now check this one out. This one is actually one of the best ones so far. There you go, see? It has all the points of the scale with a lot of just wiggling around. The leaps, there's a nice balance between steps and leaps. That's a very important thing when it comes to constructing a melody. Notice that the leaps here are not that big. And here's a really wonderful rule of thumb that you can see right here. Whenever you make a leap, a general rule of thumb is to step back in the opposite direction. So if we leap up, we step down. And again, as with all rules, so to speak, they're meant to be broken. So you don't have to follow that rule, but the more you follow that rule, the more solid your melody becomes. And that way, if you do break that rule, it'll be for a very good reason and it will be much more impactful. Just compare back here for a second. Notice that we kind of don't follow that rule entirely. We sort of do, which is why this melody isn't bad. We leap up this seventh and we leap again twice down. So because we don't hold on to that rule of stepping in the opposite direction of a leap, we indiscriminately ignore it. That's what makes this melody so unpredictable and difficult to follow. Here, because it looks like the entire time, except for maybe here, you know, except for that spot there, we follow that rule of stepping in the opposite direction of leaping, and it makes it a much more solid feeling melody. In fact, this spot right here that I just pointed out, that's actually my least favorite spot of this example, and I think that's probably because, you know, we don't follow that rule. What if, for example, what if we did something fun? La, la, la. See, I would do something like that, personally. That's my preference. There's lots of options. There are lots of alternate ways you could, quote, fix a weaker area of a melody. That's just one example. Now let's look at this one. It's a very interesting rhythmic pattern, but that's just the point. Take a look at this previous rhythmic adventure. It's not consistent. It's very haphazard, so it's very difficult for our ear to latch on to that. But if you look at this one, just looking at the pattern, it looks like a pattern. See? So you have some repeated notes, which make the melody a lot stronger. Our ear loves repetition. If you're someone like me who loves a good rhythmic line, that's what repeated notes will do for you. Let's take a listen to this. Not bad. That's probably one of the stronger ones. Because of the balance between interest and repetition, but also a little bit of predictability, so we can anticipate what's going to happen. So here are a few good examples from the classic repertoire of what we were talking about what makes a, quote, good melody gooder. All right, a good example of the consistency of material, of balance between variety and unpredictability and stability is the beginning of Beethoven's Symphony No. 6, the Pastorale. Let's just take a listen to this. See, there's a lot of repetition, and then there's the melody again, but with a different instrument. Lovely. It's one of my favorites. Here's a good example of direction and momentum. All of that including solid landing points, clear beginnings and endings, clear and understandable climaxes. You know, again, all these things that is that balance between what we expect to happen and what is a surprise. The composer, the masterful composer, is someone who knows how to balance that. You give the listener what they're expecting, but then at certain points, you take that away from them. And that balance is what creates intrigue and flow and momentum. So here's a great example of Mozart's string quartet in G, K387, movement 1. Again, a very famous opening. Check this out. Thank you. Isn't that darling? All right, now check this out. Next up, I have a little bit of Bourée from Bach's Violin Partita No. 3 in E. I love the Johann Sebastian Bach violin partitas and sonatas. And this is a great example of interesting shape. Now, what's neat about this is that these are all unaccompanied, meaning it's just for one violin and that's it. There's no piano, no harpsichord, no string quartet, nothing backing it up. And this is a great example of how a clear melody, when really carefully crafted, sometimes doesn't even need accompaniment. And if there were to be an accompaniment, it could very well be something that, just enhances what's already there. Too many times I find in modern writing that we sometimes rely too much on accompaniment, that if we have a weak melody, we can get away with having a stronger accompaniment. But what if you had a strong melody to start with, and then the accompaniment works hand in hand with it? And so check out this example of the Bach Bourée. It's very clear. Now, the other quality of novelty, a catchy quality of unique character, if a melody has all of this, it incorporates all the aforementioned points. It incorporates consistency, balance, flow, and momentum, an interesting shape that's clear. These are all things that help make it catchy. Complicated does not mean catchy. In fact, let me give you an example. This is Bartok. It's a much more complicated piece, second movement from his Concerto for Orchestra. And yet, even though it's complicated, it's also very clear. So just get a little bit of this. There's a change in timbre there. So in combination with his use of the rhythm and the trading off leaping versus stepping, there's still a lot of clarity, even though it's a much more modern sounding piece. Now, by contrast, let me play a little bit of the Rhapsody Espagnole by Ravel. So do you hear what's happening there? Ravel introduces a four-note theme that just keeps repeating underneath. We call that an ostinato. And then on top of that, he starts bringing in little snippets of a melody. a great example of alternating between predictability and surprise.
Well, I hope you enjoyed our foray into good melodies and what makes them more interesting than perhaps other ones might be. Do some experimenting yourself. See if you can find melodies around. Listen to the radio, listen to your favorite MP3s and albums, and see if you can tell why you like certain melodies more than others. See if you can sing the melody without any accompaniment, and see if it makes it stronger or less strong. And it's really fun to discover what it is that makes that melody stand out or not stand out. So as usual, if you have any other questions or want to know a specific answer to something, just shoot me a message or leave me a comment. Be sure to subscribe. And don't forget to visit isupportnewmusic.com because of the awesome Leviathan project. We're raising money to record my massive 25-minute concerto for electric violin and orchestra. What's not to like, right? So you can be a part of that and get in on some awesome gifts and just be a part of moving and shaking this awesome thing for the modern music world. All right, so until next time, hope you have a great holiday weekend, and we'll see you around.